Hey everybody, so today we're going to do another quick take, and that is, what is an idiom? Specifically, how do you identify idioms in a machine learning project? So, a fun fact is 3 out of every 10 sentences in the English language contain an idiom. So an idiom is described as something that can be figuratively different than what the words imply. So, I'm actually wearing my shirt today, Top Gun. That can be considered an idiom. What is a top gun? I know what a top and being on the top is, and I know what the things that go pew pew are, but how does that have anything to do with flying aircraft, which is the name of a movie? So figuring all of this out is difficult, even for humans that don't speak English or don't know idioms in American versus British. And we're gonna look at some examples of some Brits who were trying to figure out American idioms as we go through this very short video on what is an idiom and some approaches to identifying them with machine learning. All right, so if you're interested in that, let's keep on watching. So these are often confused with metaphors and similes. So the difference here is a metaphor is really just adding spice to language by saying, well, I'm drowning in paperwork. Well, you're not literally drowning in paperwork. It means if you're drowning, you probably have a lot of water on you, right? You have a lot of paperwork over you. So you have a lot of work to do. So a simile is just adding the word like. So if you are saying a metaphor is like an idiom, you are using a simile. These are ways of describing things that are not readily apparent to somebody that is not in the same culture or does not speak the same language or is a machine and doesn't know any of those things unless you teach it. So an interesting fact is that idiom is actually something that used to be a metaphor, but then became so commonly understood or so commonly used, it then became an idiom because idioms are usually pretty static. So with that confusion out of the way, let's look at two examples. And I'm gonna put that over here. So there are literal and figurative idioms. So the literal ones could be tip of the iceberg or breaking the ice. Those are literal things you can do and see in the real world. There are icebergs and they have tippy tops of those things. And when you are literally breaking through ice, that is breaking through ice. Now, figuratively, if I use those two, I could say that I'm brand new to an organization and I need to talk to my boss, so I need to really break the ice, or I need an icebreaker. Those are figurative. I'm not literally going and hitting ice to talk to my boss. But what it does mean is I need some way to break through a barrier, and that barrier might be, I've never had a conversation with this person. Or if I'm saying, well, you know, this problem is so complicated, this is just the tip of the iceberg. So figuratively, if I'm saying that something is just the tip of the iceberg, it means there's much more confusion and issues and other things that we're going to deal with that are not readily apparent. But that is how you tell the difference between the two. But this highlights why idioms are so hard to figure out in text and in conversation, because they can sometimes be confused with their literal counterparts that don't actually mean the same thing. So, whether you are teaching machine learning or whether you are trying to learn a different language where you just don't know the idioms because sometimes there is cultural implications. Like a great example of this is I plead the fifth. So unless you're from America, there's a legal ramification of this. I'm talking about the idiom plead the fifth. It means that you just don't want to talk about it, or you would incriminate yourself if you said something. I mean, a lot of idioms are very cultural. All right, so let's go through the 4 different ways that you can start to understand what idioms are and identify them in your context. So the first is actually break apart the idiom into its individual features so that you can start to understand what each feature is about and figure out what they have in common. So graph information coupled with something like all path nearest neighbor might be really helpful for something like this. So if I said that I'm a night owl, well, I don't mean that I hoot and I fly and I'm outside at night, but you do know that owls are usually active at night. They also have other features, but I don't have those features. But I do have a feature where I might be able to stay up way past everyone else's bedtime and still be productive. So in that context, I can understand that a night owl is something that is more productive at night, as well as myself being more productive at night. So for this next example, I'm actually going to put a little clip up here of a great channel. They're really funny, and I'm going to put a link to their full video down below. But here is an example of them trying to figure out what for behind the eight ball means.
I don't understand. Behind the eight ball.
Behind the eight ball.
Yeah.
Okay, so where would there be a ball so with a number eight on it?
Yeah.
So ball with a number eight on it. Give you a clue. I know nothing about American okay. sport. If there's anything the to do with sport. So put it behind eight. Could be something to do with pool.
No, they wouldn't say, I don't think they'd say like put it behind the eight ball. They'd be like, I'm behind the eight ball right now.
Oh, with that inflection, yeah. I think that means I'm sitting on the fence and I don't know.
No.
Oh, okay.
So I remember this one. They said that like the eight ball in a game of pool or snooker, I'm not sure which one. Like the eight ball is kind of impossible for you to get the eight ball from where you are.
Oh.
So it's like a really difficult scenario to be in.
So you can see how the context is something that they're trying to piece out. So they had to figure out what balls have eights on them. And then that led them to pool. But if they didn't understand the rules of pool, then they might still have not understood what this idiom meant. Now, ways that you can figure this out with machine learning are things like word to vec, understanding how different words always play together, or you can use convolutional neural networks where it kind of tries to figure out on its own how these things are all connected together in lots and lots of different contexts. The third way, having a controlled vocabulary of sorts, of idioms, data sets, having a corpus that is tagged with human people, determining what these idioms actually mean. So this is obviously a longer time commitment. It's also not as reliable because humans don't know all idioms if you're working with a small group of people. So these are things you're gonna have to consider, but if you couple this with some of the other approaches that we're talking about, you might have better success. I've actually seen F-scores. So if you don't know what an F-score is, up here, but it's the confidence in a machine learning model. I've seen anywhere between 71 and 97% accuracy in identifying idioms in corpi by using data sets like this. So I'm going to link below some great data sets if you want to try that out. And the last example, you're going to go back to Joel and Leah here, where you'll see that the inflection is something that they are focusing on.
Wait, say it again. With the inflection of whatever it means.
Okay. Let me have a think. I'm just really behind the eight ball right now.
I'm stressed out. I'm done.
A little bit.
I'm not going to do this anymore.
I'm in a difficult scenario.
How is this used in a phrase? What's the inflection of discourse when they are trying to figure out what this means? And if you watch the whole video, which I really encourage you to go and do, you'll see this happen a lot. So that sentiment analysis is actually a really popular way of understanding what an idiom means. It's not going to get you the full extent of what an idiom means, but it at least gets you in the correct realm. Listening to native speakers that are using these idioms is quite helpful. All right, so I hope that helped you understand what is an idiom, why these are so hard for humans and machines to understand, and some approaches that you might want to take if you encounter some idioms. The last thing I will say is one of my favorite things to do when I visit another country is to teach people idioms that are usually a little raunchy from America. So when I went to Stockholm, for instance, I taught my cab driver what being a peeping Tom meant. So this is something that I really enjoy. I think idioms are fun, and they actually speak to a lot of really cool culture and historical aspects of language as well. So with those parting words of wisdom, I hope that you are now encouraged to go and check out more about idioms because they are quite fascinating. All right, so with that, I want to thank you very much, and I'll catch you next time.